You're lost. You're trapped on a desert island. You have to remember the quotient rule. How can you remember the quotient rule? Even while trapped in that desert island, you'll remember the vague form of the quotient rule. You'll remember the numerator looks a little bit like the product rule. It's a value times a derivative minus the other value times the other derivative. But you might not remember exactly where the minus sign goes, right? You don't know if it's f of x times g of x minus g of x times f prime of x, or the other way around, g of x times f prime of x minus f of x times g prime of x. Which one is it? If you weren't trapped in the desert island, you'd have access to Wikipedia and you could just look up the quotient rule. Even if you could just look it up, let's think about it for a little bit. Why is the quotient rule what it is? To make it easy on ourselves, let's suppose that f of x is positive and g of x is positive. Now I'm trying to understand some of the derivative of the quotient, which is really how is the quotient changing when f and g are doing some changing. Let's make that really concrete. Let's suppose that the numerator is getting bigger, but the denominator is staying the same. How does this change? Well, then that is bigger, right? If you take bigger thing and cut it into the same number of pieces, then those pieces are bigger. Now, we could play the game the other way. I could keep the pieces the same size, but increase the denominator, which would be cutting them into more pieces, right? And if I take the same amount of stuff and divide it into more pieces, then each of those pieces is smaller, right? So a same size number divided by a bigger number, now this fraction is smaller. How does this relate to the derivative? Well, think back to the sign, the sign of the derivative. So same setup, f of x is positive, g of x is positive. Maybe the denominator isn't really changing, but the numerator is getting bigger. And now I want to know, how is the fraction changing? Well, if the numerator is getting bigger, the denominator staying the same, the fraction should be getting bigger, which then tells us something about the sign of this derivative. We can similarly analyze the situation involving the denominator. So if the numerator is positive and the denominator is positive and the numerator is not really changing, but the denominator is getting bigger, then the fraction f of x over g of x is getting smaller. So that tells us again something about the sign of the derivative of this ratio. It's negative, because if the denominator is getting bigger and the numerator is not really changing, this ratio is getting smaller. How does all of this help us to identify the actual quotient rule? How can we get rid of that imposter quotient rule? So we've got two guesses as to what the quotient rule might be, and I've got some information that we just thought about, right? If the function's values are positive and the numerator's getting bigger and the denominator's not really changing, that means the fraction's getting bigger. If the numerator's not really changing but the denominator's getting bigger, then that fraction's getting smaller. Now these are truths, and which of these truths are compatible with which of these guesses about the quotient rule? Well, let's take a look. This first guess about the quotient rule, let's see what happens if the numerator's not changing but the denominator's getting bigger. If the numerator is not changing, that kills this whole first term, right? The derivative of f vanishes then. But the derivative of the denominator would be positive. I'm imagining the value of the function is positive, so this is a positive number but a negative sign there, so this is now a negative numerator divided by a positive number. So if this were the quotient rule, it would be telling us that an increasing denominator makes this ratio smaller. It makes the derivative negative. That's good. That's really compatible with this picture. Now, is this compatible with that? Well, what would happen here if the denominator were increasing but the numerator were staying the same? If the numerator is staying the same, this is 0, which kills this term, and I'm just left with this. And if the numerator is increasing, then this term is positive, and I imagine the function's values are positive, so I got a positive thing divided by a positive thing. If this were the quotient rule, an increasing denominator while the numerator stays the same would make this ratio increase because this derivative would be positive. Well, this can't be. This isn't the quotient rule. It's not compatible with this fact. Well, in fact, this is the quotient rule. And we can see that it's also compatible with this first fact. If the numerator is getting bigger but the denominator is staying the same, well, the denominator staying the same makes this term 0, which kills this whole term, and all I'm left with is this. Now, I'm imagining the g is positive, and if the derivative of the numerator is positive, the derivative is getting bigger, this is positive. I've got a positive thing divided by a positive thing. That makes the derivative positive. And that makes sense. Right? If the numerator is getting bigger and the denominator is staying the same, the derivative is positive. And that's exactly what this, the true quotient rule, is saying. Fundamentally, I don't want you just to memorize all of these rules. I want you to understand why the rules are what they are. I want you to get a feeling for why there's a negative sign in the quotient rule. It really belongs there.